had it screwed up and I don't know how I did it.
All right, guys. Love you guys. We'll see you.
Good morning, everybody. Pretty special day today, and it sure is nice to see these smiling masks here. Remember in the beginning, the kids would take and they'd draw little faces on them, so I can see the smiles. before we go too far, excuse me, like last week, we'd like to address prayers and concerns right in the beginning, because I think you all know in the Zoom broadcast, we usually shut that off so we don't broadcast last names. But certainly here in the congregation, nothing is being recorded now. So we'd like to bring up prayers and concerns. And if you would, kind of like last week in the service, if you'd like to let me know right now, prayers and concerns with 15. So please pass the word. I'm sure it'll be in the what's happening announcements and everything, but I know that doesn't get to everybody, so pass that word to everybody that you know, and I'm sure the Sunday school teachers will be great, happy to see everybody in. Also during the service next week, we will be having our ordination and installation of new elders and deacons, so that'll be special. We kind of missed that last year. It kind of was difficult with the whole COVID thing. So I think that's important. We do have a new slate of elders and deacons, a few new ones this year coming on. Have announcement, peace and global witness offering is now being collected. And Russ wanted me to mention that 25% of this stays locally this year for Kairos, right downstairs. 25% stays in the Black Hawk Presbytery, and 50% for the Presbyterian USA to use globally. So that's going on now. Jackie?
Good morning. We have a couple people to welcome into our sanctuary today. One is Reverend David Jones, who is over here towards the front, and he is going to be our moderator for our meeting after the service. And on behalf of the nominating committee, I am thrilled to introduce you all to the Reverend Rotia Cornelius, and she is our candidate to be our solo pastor of First Presbyterian Church. As our committee read through many pastor information forms, Reverend Cornelius stood out as a person whose theology and commitment to living out Jesus' call to care for God's creation and all of its inhabitants resonated with each one of us. Her first career was as a physical therapist until she felt the call to be a teaching elder. She is a graduate of Dubuque Theological Seminary in Dubuque, Iowa, and is currently serving as solo pastor to two small churches in Maine, plus she's also the executive director of Missions of the Eastwood, which is a nonprofit ministry in northern New England. So please welcome with us Reverend Cornelius to lead us in worship.
I guess I did forget that the last announcement, we have a congregational meeting right after service. Gee, what an idiot, huh? Please stay. Please join me in our morning call to worship. Come and see water gushing from a rock. Come and see someone who knows you through and through. Come and see hope alive right here, right now. Come and see, then give God thanks and praise. We come to worship the God of life and love. O God, our Father, we come to you today that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. We come to you today to magnify the name of Jesus, our Savior and our Lord. Wellspring of eternal life, we come to you this day having drunk deeply the waters of anxiety and despair. Loving and caring God, we come this morning in hope. Hope that will sustain us in our trying times, our lonely times, our doubting times. Refresh us this morning with the living water of your presence and love. Open us to the possibilities of friendship, the possibilities of encountering you in unexpected ways, the possibilities of seeing the miraculous in everyday life. Send your Holy Spirit upon us today that the new truth we need may be revealed and we be reminded of old truths we have forgotten. We pray this in the name of the one who is the fountain of living water, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Walking the dog, reading a bedtime story, recycling newspapers. In every moment, in every place, God is there. Let us confess how often we do not see God in our lives, especially in how we live them. Join me now as we pray together, saying, God of living waters, we confess that we have often turned from you and wandered in our own wilderness of fear and doubt. Our thirst mount daily, seeking to be quenched by your redeeming love. Yet when that love is offered to us, we again turn away, unable to truly believe that you would heal and love us. We have behaved in very unloving ways. We have chosen to ignore those in need or to deal only passively with them. Our hearts are not placed in service to others, but rather in self-serving motives. Heal us, merciful God. Wash us again in the living water. Help us be faithful servants. Amen.
Our hope and assurance, my friends, rest in God's unfailing love and forgiveness. Open your hearts and open your minds and souls that the healing water of God's never-ending love and forgiveness may flow into and over you. Know that in this love and forgiveness, you have indeed encountered the living God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us go ahead and greet each other with words of hope, words that comes from the wellspring of love flowing within us because of our encounter with the living Christ. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you now and always.
As we read the words of Scripture, we are pointed to your living Word who walked among us, and we are surrounded by your Spirit who whispers words within our hearts and minds. Inspire us in our hearing and reflecting that we may move beyond your words into life-changing acts of grace, love, hope, and peace. Amen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 42. Just like a deer that craves streams of water, my whole being craves you, God. My whole being thirsts for God, for the living God. When will I come and see God's face? My tears have been my food both day and night, as people constantly question me, where's your God now? But I remember these things as I bear my soul, how I made my way to the mighty one's abode, to God's own house. With joyous shouts and thanksgiving songs, a huge crowd celebrating the festival. Why, I ask myself, are you so depressed? Why are you so upset inside? Hope in God. because I will again give him thanks, my saving presence and my God. My whole being is depressed. That's why I remember you from the land of Jordan and Hermon, from Mount Meisser. Deep called to deep at the noise of your waterfalls. All your massive waves surge over me. By day, the Lord commands his faithful love. By night, his song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I will say to God, my solid rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I have to walk around sad, oppressed by enemies? With my bones crushed, my foes make fun of me, constantly question me. Where's your God now? Why, I ask myself, are you so depressed? Why are you so upset inside? Hope in God, because I will again give him thanks, my saving presence and my God. This is the word of the Lord.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is. I don't know if I can follow that. Just saying. That was awesome. Thank you so much. Wow. And this thing about Reverend Cornelius, I love you, Jackie, but I don't know who that person is. So I stand in front of you today as Tia, and thank you so much for this opportunity and for all of you who did so much hard work. Thank you. Our gospel lesson today, my friends, come from the gospel according to John. And it's a bit of a lengthy passage and maybe a little well-known, but let us hear what God wants to say to us today in the reading of the scripture, John 4, verses 5 through 42. He came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, which was near the land Jacob given to his son Jacob. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus was tired from his journey, so he sat down at the well. It was about noontime. A Samaritan woman came to the well to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me some water to drink." His disciples had gone into the city to buy him some food. The Samaritan woman asked, "Why do you, a Jewish man, ask for something to drink from me, a Samaritan woman?" Jews and Samaritans didn't associate with each other. Jesus responded, "If you recognize God's gift and who is saying to you, 'Give me some water to drink,' you would be asking him and he would give you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you don't have a bucket and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water? You aren't greater than our father Jacob, are you? He gave this well to us and he drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks from this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks from the water that I will give will never be thirsty again. That water I give will become in those who drink it a spring of water that bubbles up into eternal life." And the woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I will never be thirsty and will never need to come here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go get your husband and come back here." The woman replied, "I don't have a husband." "You are right to say, 'I don't have a husband,'" Jesus answered. "You've had five husbands, and the man you are with right now isn't your husband. You've spoken the truth." The woman said, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say, your people say that it is necessary to worship in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the time is coming when you and your people will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You and your people worship what you don't know. We worship what we know, because salvation is from the Jews. The time is coming and is here when true worshipers will worship in spirit and truth. And the Father looks for those who worship him this way. God is spirit, and it is necessary to worship God in spirit and truth." And the woman said, "I know that the Messiah is coming, the one who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will teach us everything." And Jesus said to her, "I am the one who speaks with you." Just then the disciples arrived and were shocked that he was talking to a woman, but no one asked, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" The woman put down the water jar and went into the city, and she said to the people, "Come and see a man who has told me everything I've done. Could this be the Christ?" And they left the city and were on their way to see Jesus. And in the meantime, the disciples spoke to Jesus, saying, "Rabbi, eat." And Jesus said to them, "I have food to eat that you don't know about." The disciples asked each other, "Has someone brought him food?" And Jesus said to them, "I am fed by doing the will of the one who sent me and by completing his work." Don't you have a saying, 4 more months and then it's time for the harvest? Look, I tell you, open your eyes and notice that the fields are ready and ripe for the harvest. Those who harvest are receiving their pay and gather fruits for eternal life, so that those who sow and those who harvest can celebrate together. This is a true saying, the one who sows and another harvests. I have sent you to harvest what you didn't work hard for. Others worked hard, and you will share in their hard work. Many Samaritans in the city believed in Jesus because of the woman's words when she testified, "He told me everything I've ever done." And so when the Samaritans came to Jesus, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there for 2 days. Many more believed because of his word, and they said to the woman, "We no longer believe because of what you said, for we have heard for ourselves and know that this one is truly the Savior of the world." This, my friends, is the word of our Lord. Yeah, you know, this is also a little strange to me. I'm not normally all dressed up when I preach, so just bear with me. This is going to go sideways in 7 ways. And I'm standing here, and I'm thinking how hard it is to preach when you're supposed to knock the socks off the people who are soon going to vote whether they like you enough to keep you here or not. There's definitely no pressure in all of this. None. So this is not our lectionary text for this week. There was this thing for me about do you choose a text that people are not familiar with so you can teach them some new insight and they think you're just absolutely awesome? Or do you go with something that is familiar and then face the challenge that no one drifts off while you're up here trying to talk about something that they know? So I'm up for the challenge. Let's see how I do. This is a well-known story. We've heard it in the pews, maybe somewhere in Sunday school. We know it. Or at least I, in my mind, think that most know it. And there's been a lot said about this passage. But you know what? Every time I read this, this text is so rich and so deep, and it brings so much comfort. And yet, it challenges every time I read it. And this, to me, this is the gospel. It brings good news, and it sends us to go change the world. So this story today is about a woman without a name, if you noticed, kind of a nobody, maybe. It's a woman who is parched, coming to the well given to the people of Samaria by Jacob. And she comes to the well in the noonday heat, alone, when no one else is there, so she can possibly prevent and avoid the stares of others and their gossip and their abuse. This woman has been ismed all her life by the culture of the day. A woman, a Samaritan, 2 strikes against her already. See, woman didn't count for much back then. And if you're a Samaritan in Jewish company, well, you know, you're not a Jew. You're mixed race. You're impure. And then there was strike 3. Strike 3 was her marital history. True. We know that she was married 5 times, right? And that she was now living with someone who she was not married to. But we don't know the facts behind her story now, do we? And so many has guessed over time about her immoral character, but truly, truly, we don't know. See, women in those days could not live without a husband providing for them, and neither, even if they were abused, could a woman ask for a divorce. But we can imagine that was what was said about her caused her a lot of heartache, grief, and suffering and pain. This nameless woman comes to the well as an outsider, as an outcast, as inferior, maybe not even fully regarded as a person by the people in the town. But that is exactly what attracted so many to Jesus now, wasn't it? Have you ever been there, friends? One of those people who find themselves not belonging, being set aside, being nameless, bullied in school maybe because you are so different, not welcomed in a church because there's this label with five letters LGBTQ attached to your name. Or a skin dark enough that you get pulled over for who knows what the reason may be. Or a Muslim who causes fear and terror, or the prisoner who has just been released and will always be a threat to society, or the homeless person, excuse me, who is dirtying and smelling of sweat and who knows what else for days. Or the drug addict who has difficulty quitting but longs to become whole again. Maybe the refugee that is just looking for a place where their children can be safe. That, my friends, is the woman that comes to the well today, a shadow of the woman God created her to be. And she had enough of pain and of the scornful glances and of sharp words thrown her way. She had enough of her own parched soul, the dry wasteland of her life. And the last thing she expected when she came up there was a stranger sitting there who she might just have to interact with. Someone who might just get into her business a little more than she would like to. But isn't that so often where Jesus finds us? When there is absolutely nothing left and the only thing we can do is face a stranger who points us to our own dryness. Points us to our own dryness, asking for a drink. See, Jesus was thirsty and tired after his journey. And he found himself at this well in Samaria where Jews would not normally find themselves if they could at all help it, while his disciples went to get food. And really, who can blame her for her reaction? Can you hear her saying, "What? Sorry? Did I hear you right? You, a Jew, ask of me, a Samaritan woman, to give you something to drink? What, are you gonna drink out of my cup since you don't have anything to drink from? And just by the way, this is our well. Jacob gave it to our ancestors. And you ask me for a drink?" And there is Jesus who knows every heart. And he gently redirects her life and her story away from her own walls and those that others have built around her, because Jesus, you see, saw the woman not for her assigned role or the mask she was hiding behind, but for who she really was. and he challenged her to face herself by meeting her exactly in that place. And there is where he offers her something that she has been longing for, and he calls it living water that will fill her soul completely again, water that quench a thirst forever. And then he says to her, the water I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. Have you ever been where this woman is? Desperate. Sir, give me this water so that I don't have to keep on coming back here day after day. Lord, just give me something so I don't have to keep on feeling like I'm banging my head against the same wall trying to just get it right. Give me living water so that I can also be accepted, so I can know that you love me too. Not just those on the inside who have positions or great jobs or money or leadership, not just those who tell me that I'm not good enough or haven't lived right or don't give enough or don't do enough or don't pray right or do not have enough faith. Give me that water and show me how to be enough. And Jesus lets her in on something. Her life of not enough has not been a secret to him. And Jesus lays her past out to her right there, including her non-stellar track record on marriage. And Jesus calls her out on her stuff. And who of us, if I might ask, like to be called out on our stuff? Those secrets that we would like to keep deep down, far away. Because who likes to deal with the filth and the pain and the heartache of their own lives and all the secrets that we never really want to share because of what reaction it may cause, even in those who love us? So she gets a little defensive. I would too. Okay, so you're a prophet, she says. But then goes on with an almost accusatory tone. This is our mountain, Samaritans. We've worshiped here for generations. What do you know? Even though the Jews says we can only worship in Jerusalem. And what do you say to that? And Jesus assures her that where you worship doesn't matter. All that matters is who you are and how you live your life before God. And maybe, friends, maybe it was the tone in his voice that day. Maybe it was his calm presence, the gentleness in his eyes. Or maybe it was just that it was Jesus. Because when we're in Jesus' presence, everything is better, isn't it? But whatever it was in that moment, when he got to that spirit and truth part, the woman softens and says, I know the Messiah is coming. And when he comes, he will tell us everything. And for the first time in the Gospel of John, Jesus reveals his identity as the Christ, but so much more, because in the English, where it says, I am he, tells us that Jesus is the Messiah, but the Greek translation says only, I am. I am the same I am that was and is to come. The I am of the burning bush and of a rock spilling water. The I am whose breath hovered over the beginning of creation. I am the first and I am the last. beside which there is no other God. I am, and that, my friends, was the answer she was looking for, the answer we all long to hear, the only answer that will ever satisfy. I am at the well, standing in front of her, calling her on her stuff, but not letting her out of that holy engagement for a second. And for this lowly woman, marginalized, less than, that was a moment of transformation. A moment that she finally could see herself in the way that Jesus looked at her as one that matters. And it redirects her life. And she turns that life around and she runs back to the village, to those she was being, who she has been avoiding, who has been taunting her for so long. And living water is bubbling up from inside of her and pouring out through her saturated spirit so that everyone she comes in contact with at that point in time cannot help but getting soaking wet as well. And so through her tear-filled eyes, she pours out her message, I have met him. I have met the guy who knows everything and still fills my soul. And even the thirsty villagers soak it up like sponges. And the spirit that was poured into her, I am, was now redirecting the lives of others. Something life-changing happened that day. The story changed, because when you witness the life-giving water bubbling up out of someone else's life, you cannot help but be changed, can you? I am makes this happen time and time again, redirecting from a place where we have been quenched as underserved. And so as we get filled in the places we come to worship, we are redirected also. And we become those who become living waters to all those who we come in contact with. And then we change the conversation. We change the conversation and reframe the discussion, because we then become the prophets and the preachers and the teachers and the apostles. We then become the woman at the well and speak about I am. And when a subject turns to walls and fences and barricades, we need to turn the conversation to hospitality. And when the subject looks back at the past, we turn the conversation and say, thy kingdom come. And when the subject goes to Jews and those Muslims and those Blacks and those Afghans and those Mexicans, we need to say that God created human beings in his image. In his image, he created all of them. And when it turns to grief and despair, and there are hurts all around us like there are right now, we need to say, the Lord goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. And when it becomes militaristic, we offer the peace that Jesus offered. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives. Do not be afraid. And when the conversation moved to clandestine spaces and restricted places, we need not worry, because the gospel teaches us that there is nothing that is ever kept secret that will not come to light. My friends, in every community, in every church, in every place are those who live on the edges, like the woman at the well. And if not completely excluded, certainly unsure of their acceptance and their right to belong. In every community, there are those who are thirsty who struggled to make ends meet, those who have no or very little access to the fullness of life. In every community, there are those whose lives are dry and desolate, and whether that is from their own choices or because of what someone else told them, we as living water need to fill them and become the community that embrace them and include them, bringing them into a safe space of love and of support and of belonging. A place where they can live vibrant and meaningful lives and get to know themselves as worthy and see themselves in the ways that Jesus looks at them. What they long for is a place to be healed and to restore and to rediscover the fullness of life that we find in I Am. And if we call ourselves disciples of God, we need to stand in those difficult places. And we need to reframe those conversations. Because if our lives have been redirected, then we cannot be passive. But we got to shout from the rooftops about I Am and become participants in what God is already doing. Living water, which we have access to as followers of Christ, should be given to the Samaritan outcasts in our midst. And it can make all the difference in the world to them. My friends, this morning, I Am is at the well. God is intentionally seeking to flood the driest parts of us with water that will change the face of who we are as individuals and as a church. I Am is at the well waiting for us to forget all the things that we think we can do and drink deeply of the things that we can do in Christ. I Am is at the well, offering each of us a chance to redirect. And you don't need a bucket, and you don't need a glass, and you don't need a bottle to capture it. It just pours from above. All you have to do is put down your umbrella, turn your hands to the sky, and open your mouth, and then let that water soak your soul, and then drip, drip, drip all the way home. May it be so.
Thank you.
We all come to this place for different reasons. The woman went to the well at noontime to avoid the scorn of the villagers. A crowd of 5,000 followed Jesus everywhere after he fed them. And some came because they wanted more. And some came because they heard about the stories he was telling. And some came because they heard about the healings and maybe needed it themselves. And some just came because they were curious what all the fuss was about. But it didn't matter why people were there. In the end, it only mattered that they were there, that they needed something to eat and something to drink. And so we are here today for different reasons. And some of us come brimming with faith, and some of us are comfortable, and some of us are seeking for something that is a little deeper. But we are all here. And it doesn't matter why, and it doesn't matter how. What matters today, my friends, is that you are here. Because here is the place at this table where everyone is welcome. Here is the place where there are no walls dividing us. Here is the place where Christ simply says, take, eat, drink, remember, all of you. So let us gather today at this table, whoever you are and however you are, because Christ is inviting you. And Christ is welcoming all of you as guests at his table. Let us pray. Our souls long to give you praise, O God, just as the deer longs to quench its thirst in the springs of water. And when reality itself was thirsty for you, living God, you poured out the living water of your presence through day and night, and you called creation into being. We join our souls and our hearts and our minds with the multitude of your creation, singing praise and thanksgiving for your good works. We put our trust in you, and we give thanks to you, our help and our God. From the depth of your compassion to the depth of our sin, you send your beloved Jesus Christ to show your faithfulness every day, to sing your song of joy every night, to teach us your ways, O God of life. When it appeared that your strength forgot him and our enemy death claimed the victory, you were yet present, and you made the grave itself a spring of living water. We put our trust in you, and we give thanks to you, our hope and our God. In your righteousness, O God, pour out your strength upon us again, and as we gather around this meal of bread and cup, draw us near to you and lift us up with the lightness of your breath in us. Send forth your spirit of light and truth to lead us and bring us to the place you dwell in all people and in all places. And then let us worship in joy and gladness, in spirit and truth, in song and in service with all your people in every time and place. We put our trust in you. And we give thanks to you, our help, and our God. We pray through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ, who always prays with us. Amen. My friends, on the night of Passover meal, Jesus was upstairs in a room together with his friends. And on that occasion, He took the bread, and after he gave thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat, and do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and poured it and told them, "This is the cup of a new covenant poured out for you and many for the forgiveness of sins. Take this cup and drink, and do this in remembrance of me." For as long as we do eat of this bread and we drink from this cup, we proclaim the death of Jesus until he comes again in glory. Friends, this is the gifts of God for the people of God. Come and join in the feast. You come upright. This is where I'm a little not so familiar.
Please come
and share in the elements. Bread of heaven. My friends, the cup of salvation for all. You pray with me. Christ our Lord, at this table, you have given us a taste of that joyful feast that you have promised to your blessed ones. Let this meal strengthen us for the work of discipleship and help us to serve you in all that we do for the least of these, your siblings. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I'm doing a lot of praying this morning, which is really, really good because that's how we talk to God. So I want you to take a deep breath and feel the Spirit move and get comfortable as we turn towards our Lord in prayer, bringing Him our heart's desires. Let us pray. How great I am. We come to your well today in the noontime alone, hoping that we will get our thirst quenched. We came looking for you, and you met us with living water wells to share your abundance with others. And however it is, we gather as your people to find words of assurance and strength for our journey, to find your love, your life once again of enveloping us in all of your grace and of your mercy. We pray, O God, today that you will hear our prayers and the cries of our hearts, that around the well of your grace, O God, there are so many who first thirst for friendship and love. Help us to offer them the living water of community and connectedness as we open doors of hospitality. Around the well of your life, O God, are those who thirst for joy and for safety. Help us once again to offer them the living water of protection and of playfulness. Around your well, O God, there is so many who thirst for wholeness and for peace. Help us to offer them the living water of comfort, of healing, and of welcome. We pray for the health and the healing in the midst of our continuing crisis. We pray that you will strengthen the medical professionals who have spent almost their last reserve of endurance. Encourage them when deaths prevail despite their heroic efforts. Grant them courage and confidence in the facing of these never-ending trials. Show us all your signs of healing grace. And this weekend, this nation marks 20 years since the attacks of September 11, 2001. And we pray for a collective moment of pause. Help us to stop what we are doing, O God, and help us to set aside the stresses and the strain of everyday life to honor the lives that were lost, the devastated families, the first responders who ran toward danger to help and save. May the memory of this terrible and tragic day make us ever more motivated to work for peace. Peace across our world. And help us to build cultural and global and interfaith bridges and pathways and partnerships of mutual care and understanding. And merciful God, fill us at your well with peace that passes all understanding, with the hope that your kingdom will come and that your will be done. Compassionate God, bind up the wounds of the suffering among us. As we pray, especially for those in this community, in this congregation who are ill in mind or body or spirit or heart. We name before you today, O God, Laura and Gary, and all those who continue to suffer from gun violence, especially our children. Hold them who we hold dear in our hearts, and those we don't name out loud, close to you, fill them with your healing, with your presence, and with your comfort. We pray for those from Afghanistan who are seeking refuge and asylum. And we pray for this nation and its leaders that you will provide wisdom in all decisions so it will lead to the liberty of all people. Burdens we carry, God of life, are sometimes heavy, and the road sometimes feels dreary and endless. So turn our eyes towards the skies of promise and tune our hearts to your brave love. Fill our souls with moral courage so we can find our purpose and our path in you. May the life we have found in you be the gift we share with all who thirst, with all who are outcast and rejected, with all who have too little or too much, with all who are wounded and ashamed, and through us, may this corner of the world overflow with your living water. We pray through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, who prays with us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the forever. Amen.
Our collaborative Creator God calls us to join in the work of love in the world and equips us with all we need to follow God's lead. Let us be generous of hand, heart, and mind, just like God. Let us return the gifts bestowed on us as a sign of our gratitude for God's unending love. Seeking abundant love for all, let us bring our offering. Thank you.
This is the thing, get to know, you got to know yet the rituals of places. Our last hymn, my friends, let us join our voices and call us partners in Christ's service. I think that's where we are, correct? We have so go now to live in hope this encounter inspires. Be water bearers in a dry and a parched world, knowing that the God of love and the God of hope goes before you and with you always. And
may God
bless you and keep you, my friends. May God make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God lift his countenance upon you and give you all his everlasting peace. Amen.